hotel was packed. You could not move. At that point, there was an enormous buzz about Metallica. Everyone there knew this was their night.
Yeah, I remember watching Metallica and the crowds just losing their minds. You see, you know, 3,000 hands going and everybody's headbanging. And yeah, the whole night was insane.
I was a madman after they finished the show. And I just went backstage and, you know, reintroduced myself. Michael stole the show, knew right away this is the thing to do. Invited him up to the office, so they'll get you some beer, some Chinese food, and we'll talk. At that point, they were the first major label to step up to the plate and offer them something.
Metallica had been together a mere 3 years when they signed to Elektra Records in 1984, with a major label promoting their third album, 1986's Master of Puppets. They landed their biggest seller to date.
Master of Puppets was not only a hugely significant album for Metallica in the context of their career, but it was also a hugely significant album for metal, because it was the first real metal album to break the top 40 on the Billboard charts.
This was like a huge deal for Metallica. They had sort of been like, you know, like an underground club band up until this point, and now they're going to play to thousands of people every night.
Metallica were becoming rock stars, and they were living the self-indulgent rock and roll lifestyle in earnest. In fact, their wild ways even earned them a nickname.
They got the name Alcoholica because of all the drinking.
The nickname Alcoholica was great. They deserved it, and they were proud of it.
Those guys were pretty notorious at the time. You know, there wasn't a bottle of vodka they weren't best friends with.
The drinking and other things and craziness. It didn't stop. Just went on and 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 on.
The drinking, the vodka, the Jägermeister, the blackouts. The blackouts, that's all I can tell you.
And for James Hetfield, alcohol wasn't just for recreation.
James was shy, but as with anyone, the alcohol removed the fear. The shyness went away because of drinking.
I'd say during Kill 'Em All, there were times where what? We're on in 20 minutes? Where's the bottle? You know, I gotta get ready. That was my warm-up.
After 5 trying years together, the 4 members of Metallica were finally enjoying the fruits of fame and its vices as well. But they were about to be dealt a devastating blow that no one saw coming. In 1986, their 2 releases on major label Elektra, Ride the Lightning and Master of Puppets, had made Metallica rising stars of the heavy metal scene.
Metal as a whole was growing, and these guys were growing as the kings of that growing metal scene. Master of Puppets was like the culmination of them being the big fish in that sort of small but growing pond.
That summer, the band was tapped to go on a national tour with huge metal star Ozzy Osbourne, followed by a tour across Europe.
They're opening for Ozzy in 1986. That was pretty much the last time that they were opening for someone else in addition to the first time people opening for them.
The band is now on the road supporting Master Puppets in Europe. Everyone's riding high.
But with their newfound fame, there soon came a dark side. The massive European turned into one of the most painful episodes in the band's history.
They just played a smash show in Sweden, and they were making the long drive to Copenhagen, Denmark for their next show. So that night before the drive, the band actually was sort of drawing cards to decide what bunks they would sleep in. And Cliff Burton actually drew the Ace of Spades, which meant that he got to claim Kirk Hammett's usual bunk, which was up by the window. That night, it turned out to be this, you know, the worst twist of fate, because their bus ended up hitting a patch of black ice and the driver lost control. And the bus flipped over, Cliff Burton was thrown out the window, the bus rolled over, landed on top of them.
Saturday, September 27th, 1986, my phone rang super early in the morning, and it was Metallica's manager calling to tell me that he had really bad news. And his bad news was that Cliff Burton was killed.
It was really gruesome and awful. And the bus driver was saying that he hit a patch of ice and that this is why he flipped the bus. And reportedly, you know, James was screaming at him and talking about wanting to kill him. and he's running up and down this frozen, you know, stretch of highway, looking for the patch of ice that did it.
The remaining members of Metallica were taken to the hospital with minor injuries. That night, they retired to a hotel room to come to grips with Cliff's death, and no one took it as hard as the profoundly emotional James Hetfield.
They, you know, like, took James outside. They were like, because James, he couldn't stay in the room, and he's like, he was freaking out. And so they just stayed with him, and they were out in the streets. Yeah, he was screaming. You know, it was out of his mind.
Cliff's death really affected James a lot. I think for James, he felt like his family crumbled under his feet again. This is my family now, and my brother has been taken from me.
A day later, the band, everyone came home from the tour, and went back home to San Francisco. It was very sad, very, very sad time.
We were just in a state of disbelief that anything such as that could have happened, and to have happened to Cliff, who was just this incredibly warm, loving, generous soul, that you know, he was just finally at a place where he was able to give his music to the people, and to be cut off like that, it just didn't seem right.
But friends and family weren't the only ones grieving. Metallica fans were in mourning as well, and many wondered if Cliff's death meant the end of the band.
So after Cliff was killed in this terrible bus accident, the band sort of had a meeting, and they were like, you know, does Metallica even exist anymore? Can we go on? And I think it was Lars who actually was like, you know, Cliff of anyone would have wanted us to forge ahead. And his, you know, the bandmates all sort of agreed with this, and so they decided they would try to find a replacement for him.
Funny enough, I had just signed a new band called Flotsam and Jetsam to Elektra. And they, at that time, had this extraordinary bass player who was young and charming and a real go-getter. His name is Jason Newsted.
He was a huge fan of Metallica, a huge fan of Cliff Burton's playing, and, you know, he realized what a huge place it would be to fill. But the band, after, you know, auditioning him and playing with him, he quickly realized that he was the guy for the job.
There was no time to waste. With the Japanese tour scheduled for November 1986, the band hired Jason Newsted as their new bassist, but it wasn't easy to be the guy stepping in for Cliff Burton.
Unfortunately for Jason, even though they hired him, Cliff just wasn't a guy you were ever going to replace, and the band still had a lot of sadness and anger about what had happened to Cliff, and they took a lot of it out on Jason.
All they did was tease the guy from that point on. I mean, they put wasabi in his food, and they ordered a bunch of things on his room service.
There's no doubt that there was a lot of hazing, and there was a lot of grief that turned into spite towards Jason.
The worst thing of all, what got beyond just a mere prank, was they virtually cut out his tracks on Injustice for All, the album.
Just another reminder that, you know, you're in Metallica, but don't think that you've replaced Cliff Burton.
With Newsted on board, for better or worse, Metallica released their first album without Cliff Burton in the fall of 1988, and Justice for All would become their most popular album to date. But Lars and James wanted to reach an even broader mainstream audience, and they take some forceful and unexpected steps to make that happen.